Thanks everyone for coming in on this beautiful day where it's so hard not to be outside. Welcome to the board meeting for the Board of Directors for the Groveland Council on Aging. May I have a motion to call the meeting to order? Today is August 21st and it is 9:30 a.m.
Make a motion.
Second.
All in favor? Thank you. Laurel, would you be so kind as to read our mission statement? Thank you.
The mission of the Council on Aging is to advocate for Groveland's older adults, to identify their needs, to develop and implement services to meet their health, economic, social, and cultural needs, to encourage maximum independence, and to improve their quality of life.
Yeah. I mean, not before. next is the minutes for the July 17th. Meeting. Has everyone had a chance to look them over? And if there are any questions or discussions, first, may I have a motion to accept the minutes?
Motion.
Did you make a motion?
Alyssa, do you want a copy?
I've seen
it. Okay. And I have it. Did you?
So Deb made the motion.
Deb made the motion.
I'll second.
All those in favor? Any questions or discussion? Okay,
as usual.
Thank you. We have a guest with us today, Jared Stewart from Bethany Homes. He's here to make a presentation and discussion about the Garrison Street project. Probably a lot of us have either attended one of the meetings that was held here or watched them on TV. I know I've done both, so we're somewhat familiar with it, certainly. So, yeah, thank you very much for coming today.
Should I also ask we have two other guests that need to announce? So is Larry McElhenney?
Yes, we have Larry McElhenney.
I always say the same one. I'm sorry, Larry. Larry.
We've got a few more years to iron that out.
Yes, and my name too. So yeah, both of us. And I don't know Sharon.
Sharon Hines.
And you are just a community member?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Not Jen.
Oh, no. I meant, what I meant is she from Bethany Homes well. That's what I thought. So I don't need just.
And Larry is the chair of the Friends of the Council on Aging. All right. Take it away, Jen.
All right. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Thank you for having me, Barbara and Alyssa. It's good to be here. I know that we made some waves in Groveland with our project, certainly. So I guess I'd start off by saying it's been nice. I've had a few chances to meet with Alyssa. You're very lucky. You have a good director in the COA who's very supportive and has been great to talk to. And it's always nice to talk to people who are willing to listen and converse. And I think we're on the same page in terms of who we are at Bethany, who you are, our shared. I think we have a lot of shared mission as far as in terms of you know, Bethany was created to care for seniors, older adults. We've been doing that for a long time, since the 1960s. You know, our first building was 1969. And as a nonprofit organization, we really are mission-driven. You know, we're not a for-profit developer or manager of housing. You know, I think back to our executive directors before me, many of them were pastors. I think I'm the first non-clergyman. People still think I'm a reverend. They'll say, hey, Reverend, I'm the new guy. I've been there for 14 years. I'm the new guy. So it was really the churches in town started Bethany, right? It was a group of the religious leaders. Yeah. That's the name Bethany, yeah. Right? The name Bethany is historical and biblical. So it was really the root. I think the need in the 60s, not to go too far back, I won't tell you the whole history, right? But the need at that time was there really wasn't decent housing options for older adults. You know, it was rest homes or nursing homes, but they weren't good solutions, right? So in the 60s, with a lot of the social programs that came out, the HUD 202 program was one of those, which really started this independent senior housing type projects, right? And we've had a lot of success. I think what we've done in Haverhill downtown with, you know, our three properties, Mira Vista, Mission Towers, and Phoenix Row, from the 60s and 70s, we've created homes for thousands of people over the years. And we've layered in supportive services to that independent living, right? We do have some assisted living at one of our sites, but mostly it's independent. And the goal, you know, from the beginning was to help create housing where seniors can live independently for as long as possible, right? We have really good nursing homes in the area, but people don't want to always go to a nursing home. So what we're able to do at our facilities, at our housing sites, is provide a place where people can be independent. You know, independent, that might mean, well, you might need a little bit of help with certain things, right, during the day, but that's okay, you're still independent, right? You can, we can do meals, we do supportive services, we do all those things. And, you know, it's always encouraging and a little sad sometimes when seniors say, hey, this is the best place I've ever lived, right? That's great to hear from our residents, but it's a little sad. Where else have they lived along the way? So we know there's a need out there. And in Groveland, I think, you know, if you've been to those meetings, we've managed Nichols Village. We started with Nichols back when Mr. Kamet was there. He passed away last year, as you may know, Dick Kamet Sr. He partnered with Bethany in the late 90s, early 2000s, and built Nichols Village. We've managed it since that time. And so we've been in Groveland, familiar with Groveland, and the Garrison Street property, as you may know, was initially intended to be, that was the Nichols home, which was intended to be a home for, the term from 1925 was the indigent and aged elders, right? Or home for men and home for men or women. So indigent is not a great term, but it's an old fashioned term, but now it's old, you know, it's affordable housing, right? So that was the intent. So at the time when Nichols Village was built, they obviously decided with the trust that they had that they wanted to do something bigger. So they obviously built something a lot bigger that wouldn't fit on Garrison Street. But the intent of Garrison Street was for that. So in talking to the Nichols Foundation over the past few years, they did grant us permission to say, yeah, if you're able to develop affordable housing there, we would be supportive of that. So we've started to obviously come up with plans to try to address that. And in looking at Groveland, as I've said at the presentations, you know, the affordable housing stock in town is pretty low. It's the 3%. And we know the Salem Street project is out there that's been approved 4 years ago. Maybe or maybe not that'll happen. That factors into affordable housing. That project, though, as you might know, and I'm not here to speak against a project, but that project is not a senior affordable housing property. It is family housing. And although all 192 units would count towards the affordability housing stock in Groveland, only 25% of those units are actually truly affordable, right? So 75% of that property would be market rate apartments. So even though that might help the town meet that that requirement of 10%, it isn't really addressing, in my opinion, the need for seniors and for affordable housing for seniors. So that's why we're looking at doing what we're doing. The project we're proposing on Garrison Street is you know, it wouldn't be 100% affordable. We'd probably have a couple of market rate units out of all the units that are there, because there is a need for that too. And when I say market rate, all I mean is if people don't meet those income guidelines, if somebody is higher than an 80% area median income, but they want to stay in Groveland, it'd be nice to have a few housing options where they could move in and have that type of option. But most of it would be affordable, which would be people at the, you know, 60% or lower area median income. And when we look at, you know, the housing production plan and all the other things in Groveland, it shows there is a need. You know, we've done our own market research, and that kind of confirms what is really already published in that housing production plan, is that there are a lot of seniors in Groveland who need affordable housing, and it's going to continue to grow for the next 25, 30 years, right? It's going to continue to go up and up and up over time. I think the stats show that maybe one in three Groveland residents would be over 65 by the year 2040 or 2050. So anyway, that segment, everyone's getting older and living longer. So that segment of the population is going to continue to grow. And I think that need for some affordable housing options are important. Housing is really expensive right now, as we all know, right? And the supply is very low. And I'm sure there's lots of debates, and you can talk to economists and you can read the reports, but it doesn't seem like there's enough housing to go around, and it's not affordable enough for a lot of people. And we have had, you know, in Groveland, when we looked at the statistics, I think this is in that report, I think there's 135 senior households that are at the poverty level or below currently. Wow. So some people in town might think, oh, we don't really need this in Groveland. But I would say there are people, I believe, in Groveland who could certainly benefit. You know, that's the comment that's been made, is I don't see any benefit in this for Groveland. And I think, well, I don't know. The housing production plan says that people here need it. The people here now, I mean, what are your options? And we have had some people in Groveland who, older residents who have been made homeless because of the conditions of their home, I would say. And they've applied to live at Haverhill because that's their only option. So that's the option now. If you can't stay in Groveland, you can't afford it as a senior. If you're looking for affordable housing, you have to move out of town, right? And there's other options. You know, we obviously have sites in Haverhill. There's probably in Newburyport, North Andover, but you're having to leave town. So that's part of our goal too, is just to say we'd like to provide a place for people to stay in town and downsize. And again, not to keep going back to that housing production plan, but it does talk a lot about that. There's really no downsize option. A lot of the households in Groveland are currently overhoused, right? Mm-hmm. You have one or two people living in a 3 or 4 bedroom home. And the town has also said, you know, we'd like to have a place for people to downsize so that we could have families come. And then people might say, well, then the schools are really going to have a lot of enrollment. And I understand that concern, but I also, in reading the reports, you know, enrollment in Groveland was at about 1,300 students 20 years ago, and now it's at 900.
Mm-hmm.
So it's 300 or 400 less. And that projection of the age group, that younger student age group, is not going to grow much over the next 20 years. So I hear it, I understand it, but I think the statistics would say, you know, we build a 45-unit building, seniors move there, that frees up some households, but even if everybody moved in and they had 4 kids each, which won't happen, you know, would you have more kids? The stats don't really show, because there is development going on in town, right? You see new homes being built, and a lot of the new homes I see, I look at, they're beautiful. $1 million for a single family home.
Mm-hmm.
So the affordable side is like, okay, so anyway, I think my message to you, I appreciate you listening to me. You know, I'm just kind of speaking off the top of my head, but I think there is a need there. And I think what we're trying to do, you know, we're not a developer who wants to come in and like, let's cash out, let's cram all these apartments on site and let's leave town, right? We've done this for a long time. We're in Haverhill, we're already in Groveland. Again, we manage our own housing. I think our focus is more on there is a need here. We certainly do want to listen to the community. You know, I've heard the feedback. I've seen the comments. I've been to the meetings. People have been very forthright with their comments, and I hear that. And we do want to work with. We do want to work with that. We do want to hear what the community says, what they want, what they need. So I think I'm reasonable. We try to be reasonable. We try to be thoughtful. We try to work with. We want to be a good neighbor. We want to be a good community member. So I'm open to that. So I guess that's where I would kind of wrap it up. I'm glad to answer questions. I'd also love to hear if you have comments, thoughts for me, criticisms, complaints. I'm used to it. I'm hearing it all. The one thing that I do know, obviously, is that, you know, with most things, you know, you come out with something like this and opposition is going to be early and loud and loudest. But there has been people who have shown support. It's hard to give support, right? Stand up in a meeting and say, hey, I'm behind this one. 7 people just said, I'm against this. So I think there is support there. And it's easy to focus on, you know, the opposition. And we know that that's there. But we want to be fair to people. You know, we're not trying to do anything that isn't needed or not wanted. But I'm sure plenty of people are against this and probably, you know, don't want to hear from me. And that's okay. So we're going to keep moving ahead. I did bring some postcards. And all these are, is we did create a website that shows information about the project. So, and also there's questions you can answer and polls you can take on that site. So again, this is just something that if you go on and look, we try to have a place where you can go to get the right information. Here's what we're doing. Here's what we're trying to plan. And if you want to take the poll or answer questions and get feedback, that helps us have a place to get it as opposed to trying to just track down emails and everything else. So glad to pass those around. Maybe when I go, you can sign up if you haven't already. But again, I'll stop there. I know I'm talking a lot. I don't mean to bore you, but I do appreciate you having me come and kind of share kind of where we're at. So feel free. Yeah.
I have not watched all of the presentations. But I have a question.
Yeah.
And I think I asked it on a website. Will these units remain affordable in perpetuity?
They will. Yeah, I think now
that's happened here in town.
Yeah. So I think years ago, there were restrictions by the state that would allow people to maybe do like a 30-year restriction, and that would go back to market.
Right.
But it's become so competitive now that I think with your application, if you don't agree to make it basically in perpetuity, then you won't get approved by the state.
Okay.
So the state really wants these to be perpetual affordability that restrictions. And most of the programs have the tax credit program typically has a 30-year restriction, but the state has other funding that they tie longer periods. So usually it turns into, they say 99 years, which is almost perpetuity.
Right.
So
and
yeah.
The building's going to need to be.
Right. for our track record too, I'd say, you know, our Marista building, we built in 1969, and that came up, that had a 50-year mortgage that matured in 2019. And, you know, at that point, you know, we could have said, hey, let's take this market and make more money. But no, we renewed under a new HUD insured mortgage and have another 40-year affordability restriction. So our intent as a developer and management company is to keep things, that's our mission, is affordable housing. So our intent would be to say no. And also the restrictions there are much more stringent than they were. But yeah, you will hear some of these older projects probably built in the 80s or 90s now might convert, right? A new developer could buy that project and right. Take it off the affordability rules and turn it into market.
And
that happens
just,
all over.
Yeah, yeah. And, I mean, that's yeah. One thing. I think it's a good thing that it would remain, because then that keeps our numbers where it should be, or helps to keep the affordability also.
Right.
And that's, I've seen it happen a couple of times here in town where, it's affordable. And then, you know, a few years later, they're selling for market price.
Yeah.
And it's like,
those happen.
It's not good.
Yeah. The state, I think they also put in some of these contingencies, the right of first refusal. So if one of those was maturing now and a owner could take it market rate, that the right of first refusal says they can't do that. They might be forced to sell it to somebody else who would keep it affordable. So the state almost has the right of first refusal to say, no, we're going to take that project from you, or we're going to give it to somebody else who would keep it affordable. So, but I think still now we're probably in those tax credit programs started in the 80s. So we're kind of in that window of the 80s and 90s where these 30-year restrictions are now expiring. So some of these you're probably hearing, and that's people say, wait, what's going to happen with this? Well, it's a lot different now with new projects.
Okay.
But also our mission's different too. We would want to keep it affordable for the long haul. Some of those funding programs are at least 50 years, but the 99-year or perpetuities become pretty typical. Yes.
Knowing that many older adults need oxygen or need medical support that's powered by electricity.
Yeah.
When you do your housing, so you'd have a 45 unit building built, would there be the electric department here in Groveland is amazing.
Yeah, they're great.
A+.
Yeah.
But if power ever did go off, would there be backup generators to support?
Yep, definitely. Okay. We have that at all our locations. I think it's a requirement now, but we certainly would sometimes, and that would power most of the time critical type things like the elevators,
right?
Emergency fire alarm, heat, water, all that kind of stuff. It might not give you every outlet in your apartment.
Right,
usually I try to have a dedicated outlet, or we do have dedicated outlets that are powered by the generator for oxygen too in our building.
Yes.
So yeah, we definitely would do that. Actually, Groveland is great in terms of municipal electric. We do a National Grid at other sites, and I won't speak poorly of anybody, but it's nice working with municipal. Our experience at Nichols has been great, and even from a rate perspective, they're really good.
Yes.
We're very fortunate about that.
Yes.
Yeah. So yeah, no, we definitely have
good
emergency power. Yeah, for sure. Yes.
So I think this is very much needed. I'm very much in favor of it. I live within half a mile of the location.
Okay.
I have no issues with it being there at all.
Great.
It's the intent of the property. But how can we help? Is my question. Or how can, I don't want to speak for the whole board, but how can I as an individual help?
Yeah, no, that's good. So again, I think, the website that we have does have a place for feedback. So
yeah, I've done
you
that.
Go on there
yeah,
and,
I've done
and
that.
Put
yep.
positive comments. It's good because what we'll do is we keep track of that. So that way we can then, you know, the state's going to get a letter back from the Board of Selectmen in response to the project. So there's going to be some back and forth. So it will be helpful to have that, because then we can show, hey, look, we've collected feedback from community residents. Here's the comments we've got. Or 100 people responded and, you know, 85 said they support this. So it's just a way for us to try to collect data. So that is really helpful. As we go forward, too, you know, I think I wouldn't mind having in another meeting or two. I don't want to necessarily go and get beat up again, but it would be helpful if we had a meeting where supporters came and said, hey, how can we help do this? Also, too, if you'd like, if I can get email address or contact information so I can stay in touch with you. So if we need a letter of support, or if we need to collect data, it'd be good. I've been trying to get a hold. I'd like to meet some people on Fairview Circle, but
yeah, I mean, they are the people that probably have the most legitimate concerns, just because it is going to, you know, I mean, I listen to the meetings and, you know, the concerns about runoff, those are legitimate things that hopefully can be addressed.
It's definitely, I'd like to meet with them. I know one of the abutters who actually used to work for us is retired, but she used to work. So I'd like to reach out to that group and even go over and visit and try to get an understanding of what's happening over there, right? I've heard about water runoff. Maybe they get water in the basements, how would this affect that? And then that's something, you know, our engineers can take a look at and say, how do we improve drainage on the site, or how do we deal with stormwater? I mean, those are all things we take care of anyway, but if there's an issue with grading and if there's an issue with stormwater, whether it's retention basin or some sort of storm scepter type system, it'd be good. We don't want to put something in and then cause a bigger problem. I mean, I've seen that happen where I used to live in Haverhill in a condo. There was a development went in that changed the drainage by my condo, and I got flooded one time. And, you know, it's like, wow, that wasn't great. So I've been through that. But maybe before I go, if you want, I could send around, maybe if you want to write down your name and contact info, just so that way I could reach out. And I think also getting the word out, if there's other people you know that are supportive, reaching out to people, you know, sharing a card with them and saying, hey, go on, take a look at this. This is a good thing. We really like to help support this. Again, I think it's the supporters are often not going to be as loud or as early to the party. So the sooner we can get supporters to speak up, and I don't want to ask anybody to do anything they don't want to do, right? I'm not saying, hey, stand up at a meeting and say anything, because there's other people around who are on the other side. So, but if you feel compelled, certainly the support would be appreciated. But I think trying to build some sort of coalition, or maybe not coalition, but just a group of people that are supporters would be really helpful, because that's, you know, when it comes down to it, when the town listens to us, if we go to the zoning board or whatever board for approval, it would be nice to have at least a balance on both sides of people who are for, people who are against. We know there's against, but the for. And, you know, what I said too is we've had these meetings, and I know there's people in opposition. Those meetings, probably we had 40 or 45 people. Groveland has over 6,000 residents. So there's a lot more people out there that probably even haven't heard. They're busy living life. They've got families to raise. You know, what's going on? I heard something about it, but I don't really know. And the thing that we're competing against too is social media, right? We were talking about this last night at a board meeting, where social media has just become a place for people to just express vitriol and anger, even about the most minor things. You have to take a stroll through Facebook, you know, somebody says, hey, I really like this or that. And somebody says, yeah. And somebody says, no, you're horrible. And it's just, it goes downhill quickly. So combating social media, I think we can't, you know, take too much of social media to heart, because it's kind of a mind social media. So anyway, long answer, but feel free, and I'd be glad to reach out.
I would like to ask you a question. You have mentioned at meetings of building 145 unit building, and then assessing, and then maybe the other one. What would be part of the assessment process that you'd go through after building the first one?
Yeah, it's a good question. So I think the first thing would be, once we get the first building completed, is ensuring that, you know, you get to full occupancy fairly quickly, and that people, you know, move in, right? We have people there, and then is there a demand for more? So if we were able to build this building, fill up 45 units, and if you end up having a waiting list, then I'd say, all right, well, this is obviously an indication there's more of a need. But I think that'll happen. I think based on looking at projections and future numbers, I feel comfortable with that. But things change, right? The economy, we've seen things happen. 2008 was a big setback. Now we've had the COVID pandemic. So who knows, you know, if we get this built in the next 3, 4, 5 years, if it were to happen, 3 or 4 or 5 years from now, what's the economy like? You know, are interest rates really high again? Is it a good time to build? Is demand changed? Is something in Groveland changed? You know, the water situation in town has come up recently. So that's a little concerning to say, okay, well, if we put in new units, is the plans for the water for the town going to be adequate by that time? So it would be mostly based on demand. Again, I think right now it shows that it'll be there. I'm a little more conservative, and also I would be okay if we did the 45 units initially, and then a few years rolled by and say, hey, boy, this doesn't seem like it's appropriate right now. I would be in no rush to move ahead. You know, if the second building were never to get built because it wasn't needed, there wasn't the demand, or for whatever reason, That's okay. You know, I think the advice or the pathway we're following is to try to get permitted for as many as we think we could do. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, kind of building part of it and then seeing, wait and see. And that just, to me, that just seems to be my approach. I hope it's wise. You know, I certainly, I wouldn't be comfortable at this point building the full 90. It just that I understand the comment that that feels big and it seems big. And I kind of agree, like, okay, is that right for that site? Could we do it? Yeah. I'd like to see. I'd like to get one there. Because also visualizing that site, I want to make sure it does fit. You know, people have complained that it doesn't fit the look and feel. And it's like, well, we're still kind of in that schematic phase. And mm-hmm. let's try to make this look like it fits in the community. So we're still working on it. And also just the height. You know, the people on Fairview are concerned about, like, okay, is it too tall? I'm thinking, okay, well, I'd like to get over there and take a look. You know, how would it look from over there? And is there a way, if we don't do, you know, if we didn't do, it's really two stories plus the walkout because it's a grade. But, you know, if you didn't do the top level, there's a way to spread it out more to make it, to bring it down. So those are all things we're just, you know, I don't, you know, this is how my mind works when I talk about these projects. We're still working on them. You know, it's like we're presenting something because you have to kind of bring something to the table. But having just gone through this in Haverhill the last 5 or 6 years, we did a major renovation and a new building. It really is this iterative process of just, you know, going along, making decisions. How can we go up? Do we go down? I mean, the building we just completed in Haverhill was going to be 61 units, and we ended up going to 48 for a lot of different reasons. Cost was one, COVID, supply chain issues, all these things happened. We'd already gotten approved for 61 units, and we said, boy, we really can't do that now. So we essentially took the whole floor off the building and went down a level and did 48. So that's how I look at this. Like, I don't know how it's going to turn out, honestly. Here's our plan. This is what we'd like to do. Again, the needs there. I hope that me, Bethany, we're reasonable. We try to work with the town. We try to get feedback. What do the seniors need? What's wanted? And try to incorporate.
Thank you. Yeah. Now we know it keeps you up at night.
Well, you should sleep pretty well. Last time I did wake up, and I was thinking about this. Wait a minute. It just, yeah, it keeps your mind. So I'm just kind of going a little bit.
I just wanted to mention one thing you had mentioned about the need for affordable housing here in Groveland. We do have River Pines, which is subsidized housing, but that has a waiting list.
Yeah.
And the
fact 4
that it
years.
Has, yes,
4
years. It's a very long waiting list.
What, 4 years?
Yeah, I have a neighbor who's been on it for over 2 years, and she's a Groveland resident, so she's been waiting just as long. So there is definitely a need there.
Yeah.
That speaks very well to that. And also, yes, there has been a lot of opposition, not always voiced in the nicest way, sometimes confrontational, but you've been very gracious with it.
Mm-hmm.
And they do have valid concerns, but you are willing to listen to those concerns, address those concerns, the fact that you're willing to go over to Fairview Circle and take a look and see if there will be a runoff problem. And the fact that it is still a work in progress. We here, you know, I speak for myself, I'll speak for everyone, are here to support our older adults and to do everything we can to make sure that they have long, healthy, happy lives and fulfill themselves as much as possible. So yes, I do support this project, knowing that it is still a work in progress, and I for one look forward to it happening.
I appreciate that. Thank you. I'll just add one more thing. I know you got a meeting and you didn't want to probably listen to me the whole time, but you know, talking to Alyssa too, you know, as I think I've said, we can't promise to build a senior center on site. I know that, you know, the Council on Aging, the older adults don't have a senior center in Groveland now, but most of our communities, we do build a community room that's large enough to have bigger meetings, whether that's, you know, bingo or activities or games or props or whatever. So we'd like to be able to do that here too. And we've even talked about trying to make that bigger so that if we do have visitors from offsite, Council on Aging, to come up and have integrated meetings, we try to do that downtown. We try to say between our buildings, hey, why don't you come over? We're going to have a big event, you know, at this building, and we will transport people to that site for a bigger event. Sometimes that's musical entertainment. If some of the musicians are comedians, it's kind of fun. But I'd like to have that here too, as a place where, you know, even if you don't live at Garrison, you'd still be able to, as a member of the community, to come and coordinate with Alyssa to say, hey, we're going to have a joint event with Council on Aging. That'll be a musical event or whatever. And to me, that's kind of being part of that community, is we want to have people there active and engaged and have a chance to really live, you know, full supportive living, but also for other people, if they're on the waiting list, if they're not, just trying to be open to say, hey, we'll have coffee hour. once a week, come in, play games and do that. So try to open that up too. Again, I don't want to overpromise. Hey, we'll build a senior center. That would be nice, right? But that's a big task. But at least a space where we would have that large enough community life type room where people could gather and be a resource to the town beyond that. So that's the hope, just to put it out there. But thank you.
Really appreciate you saying that. I'm just going to tag off of that real quick is that certainly we do programming at other areas, but right now any programming that we do at these offsite locations are often only for those residents only. And so I really like that Jared and Bethany communities are potentially open to having an inclusive gathering space for the community as a whole, because our older adults who are living in Groveland, they want to stay in Groveland and they don't want to be secluded from their other people, just you know, like us. We don't want to be secluded from others. So really appreciate that. I would say we looked at our stats on just the number of people that come to us, and we know that that's a very small number comparatively to a whole council. The people that are comfortable coming to us at the Council on Aging, we've had about 34 people ask about housing and working on housing in the past couple of months. We have 11 active cases, and this is with Carrie, who's here 16 hours a week. Mm-hmm. She's here 2 days a week, and she's actively working with 11 open cases to find housing for people. And housing, like many of us here, of all different income levels and mobility issues, and they want to be put on that list because they say, I'm going to stay here in Groveland. I'd love it to be sooner than 4 years, but I don't want to look anywhere else. And
I mean, I know two friends of mine who were on that list, they finally went to Able because there was nothing, they couldn't get in.
Yeah.
And they hated to leave. One of them was a board member, and he had to leave.
Appreciate
so,
it.
Yeah.
Yeah, question. Is it still kind of a waiting game with the state? Where are you in that?
So from what I understood, I think the select board had asked for an extension on the, because we had submitted our letter, the state sent the letter to the select board asking for comments. I think that 30-day comment period was extended to the end of August from what I heard in the meeting. So I believe the select board is going to send a letter to the state, and then the state would review that, and then they would let us know whether we're approved in terms of project eligibility. So what they're determining is really, is this project qualifying for a subsidy through their programs? They take the feedback from the town and our application, and then they would let us know. So we probably wouldn't know, I guess, if that's the end of the month. I assume it'd be sometime in September we might hear back from the state. So we're kind of waiting for that to see how that turns out. And at that point, you know, our board met last night and we said, we're gonna wait to see what the state says and their response, and then reconvene and move ahead from there. Depending on what we hear.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. So it's ongoing, but if you want to provide a name and email, feel free. I wouldn't make anybody do this, but pass it around if you'd like, and I'm glad to reach you. Thanks, Barbara, for having me. I don't know if you have any other questions or any other comments.
I did take a chance. I did look at the website, and I started taking the survey, and we'll finish that. But
I'll leave a few. So actually what I'd do maybe is I'll leave these with you, Alyssa. If people come in too, you can feel free to pass those on. There's a pretty good amount there.
Thank you.
Yes.
Just did that one. This is a survey the selectmen put out. So two ways of having your voice.
Yes,
I'm going to take a stack. Is that all right if I take a stack?
Yeah. I didn't see the survey they put out. I think they had the results they shared at a meeting maybe a few weeks ago, or is that a different survey?
Okay. I just did the survey. I didn't see that.
Okay. Yeah.
I don't watch all the selectmen meetings or attend all of them. Okay.
Since we are on video and with our friends at home, I just wanted to name the website for Bethany Communities. It's garrisonvillagegroveland.com. So there's also on our Facebook page.
Yes.
All right. Thank you.
Thanks again for having me. Nice to meet you all. Appreciate it.
Yes,
I'll just wait till I get the list back. That's
all right. Do you like our newsletter?
Yeah, that'd be great.
Thank you.
That's a terrific so,
yes, and wonderful newsletter.
She did, yeah.
Okay.
A letter for support for the Council on Aging Health. And you had done that, so
yeah,
and
you
so. Yeah. That does help. Certainly helps. For sure.
Do we have that list going on?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Larry's. I'm trying to remember my COA email. It's been a while.
Oh gosh, you want me to look it up? Yeah. Well, while we're waiting for that, should we go ahead and
thank you for your time. I'm sorry. It's
thank you.
Really
important, right?
Thank you.
Very important. So thank you. Mm-hmm. Director's report. Melissa.
Awesome. So it's a hefty report. But just wanted to share with you, you know, last time we met was my 1 year anniversary. So certainly spent time reflecting on that 1 year. You know, again, just truly appreciate my time and all the support that you all have given to me. You know, in particular, just really excited about the new programming that we're able to provide to our older adults. Again, emphasizing that absolutely we are here to serve the community. So we would love to hear ideas about what you're looking for and what would be helpful, both for social recreational, but also for learning and health and support. And certainly a highlight was to be able to complete our team to be at full capacity, full staff. So that means, you know, myself, assistant director and outreach, along with two van drivers. And Maureen Lee has also been filling in as a late for a sub driver when we need somebody, which has been awesome to be able to have somebody to step in so that we don't have any down days. So yeah, that's sort of my very quick recap. I'm very happy to meet with people individually or small groups if you wanted to talk about, you know, sort of my own in-depth self-reflection on my time in the past year. Don't hesitate to let me know if you want to meet one-on-one. Evidence of success. So I actually pulled these for a different report and was excited to share them. So, you know, we had this gut feeling that numbers had improved quite a bit. They really did.
Amazing.
So, total people served in 2023 and this is people coming in so multiple times, you know, but individuals coming in, you know, maybe four times a week. So increase from 8,463 in 2023 to 10,859. So that's almost a 30% increase of people participating in our programming, which is awesome. Participating in programming, but also the outreach support, you know, the housing application, the food pantry and so forth. So a lot of really great things. Any questions I could answer on that right now? So finance looked a little different this time. And Deb and I can talk. We haven't yet had a chance to talk. So you give me the feedback. So, you know, last year I walked in, it was the beginning of the fiscal year, and I put something together and I think it worked for us. But it was a lot of detail, which I do like, and I still have, and I even have even more detail than that. I break it down by program and this and that. However, for our board report, I thought, you know, the two big things to make it simplified is working with the actual budget for this year, as opposed to our account balances. So that's the numbers that you see there. Certainly, if anybody wants to know at any point in time what our account balances are, I have that information, more than happy to put it in there. And I put it in there this time too. And then I just sort of did a high overview of what the budget line descriptions are. So we have outreach services. So that means anything in regards to outreach, in regards to expenses, not salary. So that could be supplies like Ziploc bags or buying. I've allotted some, funds for Carrie to do to supplement, some of the needs. So paper towels and things like that she can do. And/or if she's doing a workshop that has a fee to it, she'll be able to take out from there. Programming services is really everything else that doesn't fall into outreach. So that's sort of the biggest one in regards to the budget line. Again, that covers material, supplies, workshop people, similar things to outreach, just not the food part. Transportation. So this is where our MassDOT grant will mostly take care of, because we don't have a transportation expenses paid by the town this year. So that's all paid for the MassDOT of $5,000. And so that will be probably the majority of it, I anticipate, will be fuel costs. We do have registration fees. We just took the van in. We'll need to replace the tire soon. So that sort of thing. They will also pay for the prorated rate of our cell phones, so that the van driver's cell phones are covered by this grant. Granted, it's only $5,000. We'll stretch it out as much as we can, but certainly we have formula grant and our revolving account as well. Administrative costs, again, all the regular things you would think of administrative costs. The big thing being the My Senior Center platform, which we've already paid out this year, and the cost for movie licenses so that we can show them publicly and not get in trouble, things like that. And then professional development. I personally find it as someone in leadership important to put down the things. We put money towards things that we value, right? And so I wanted to name it instead of putting it under administrative costs or putting it maybe even under programming or outreach for individuals. I wanted to name it as its own category that we want to support the team in their professional growth. And so that's aligned there. Certainly contingency and then the town budget, which is pays for all of our salaries as a whole. So the town budget. Any questions on the new format?
It makes so much more sense. Really
does. Okay. No, it's fine for me. It's fine. For the board, I think it's excellent.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Again, I do have excruciating detail on my side, if anybody Just because I want to see so that the next year we can plan even better.
The excruciating detail is important, but probably not for the whole
world. Yes. But I am excited to share with, particularly with Nisha and Carrie, their budgets, really trying to ensure that they feel empowered to take on that they know what they're working with. So they don't always have to come to me and be like, is this okay? Can I do this? So that they know their budget and can make the most of it. So on to the details for July. Again, we're just 1 month into the fiscal year. For FY25 annual budget, I put it as 245, 447, 40. Again, the bulk of that, of course, is salary. You'll see the breakdown on the pages in the back. To date, this is just for July, we've had just under 1500 come into the revolving account. For those that are new, revolving account is where gifts go in, where program fees go in, and that is can be continued on to each fiscal year. Formula grant, no revenue as of yet. Again, that will be just about $26,000 for the year. It comes from the state based on the number of people coming in, based on the 2020 census number of people that are here in Groveland. They typically make one, late winter, then another one early spring.
People are seniors.
Older adults. No, the number of older adults living in Groveland, every year it is, of course, part of the state budget. So it increased from $12 to $14 last year per older adult. They're going to try to increase it to $15, which would be for, FY26. But definitely keep your ear to the ground for legislative work and support on that. Appreciate it. So we would not be able to do our programming without those months. I stated the balances here, in the revolving account, a good healthy balance. For just an FYI, as you'll see on, if you look at the details, that I'm not spending any more than we plan to take it in that revolving account, so not dipping into what's already there that will count on using what comes in this year for our annual budget. Any questions on the finance stuff?
Thank you for being so conscientious.
So I do think at some point, we do need to have a strategic plan. Mm-hmm. I'll plant that seed out there. Because we do have a nice little foundation, and what do we want to do with those funds? And do we continue to save for our contribution towards the senior center along with friend support and others? What does that look like? So thank that seed for our later conversation. a note from the assistant director, Nisha. We had talked a little bit about her reports going forward because she's sort of new to this this past year being part of the report. And so she included just a little story to really sort of acknowledge what's going on and all that she does there. She had a tremendous turnout for the transportation fair that was held at the end of July. So we had all of our transportation services were represented there, and we had probably just under 30 people show up. So that was great. Marianne Ney was the constituent service manager for Senator Tarr. Everybody, that's what they have to do. So it was a lot of fun. So and then we're also working on a number of handbooks, Nisha and I are. So the first one being a COA membership handbook. So the idea is to have not only systems and policies in place that we can all be aligned with and have transparency into, but also to make somebody feel a little bit more welcome to the club when they join in. So, both roles. We can use it internally, again, for us to be, these are our policies. And, particularly thinking about our individuals living with dementia, what supports can they expect from us if they're going to go on a trip? And we want to make sure that they're all in place. So the answer right now is people are on their own, so they need to have somebody accompany them on their trip, and should be a great time. And or mobility issues, we don't want to put hands on people, and so you do need to be able to move on your own. Certainly we have Lyft and we'll assist in that way, but we need people to be able to go up and down.
So yeah. Groveland Day is an opportunity to let the public, to let more community members know about the Council on Aging. So would it be a goal to have some kind of information, if somebody's interested in it, for perhaps next year's Groveland Day, or for this year?
Okay. I'm not sure.
I'm not
So we'll be there. We'll be there to give out information.
Yes.
She's saying, will the handbook be ready this year or next year?
The handbook will be ready in the next month or so, but that will really be for when people sign up. So when they sign up,
right,
welcome.
Right.
There you go.
Do they do that at Groveland? Have they done that at Groveland Day? And
so we haven't had a handbook
before. I know. Yeah.
No. So I think she's saying when you
come in and get your little ticket thing, clicker thing, right? Uh-huh. When you sign up. So
yeah.
All of us have that already. That we can.
Oh, that's not what I was thinking about. I was thinking about this general information. As
we'll have our brochures that we can get. So we'll definitely have those out there.
This handbook, like you won't get the handbook unless you ask for it because you're already signed up.
Oh no, we want everybody to have one.
Oh, well, you're saying as you sign up.
Yeah. So particular, that was our motivator, so that people know. But those are chances. Because it also has information, which we've been running a lot into, is, you know, the release of information form. People don't have to sign it. Absolutely. Nobody has to do anything they don't want to. But if they do, oh, it makes it so much easier when that emergency happens for us to be able to communicate with family, for us to be able to communicate with any other services that you have. And certainly it can be changed at any point, but you know, things like that, or your emergency contact at the very least. Can we have somebody that we can call in the event of an emergency while you're, you know, doing programming with us?
Oh, this could have a lot of benefit.
Yeah.
Wow. Good. Good plan.
So we're working on that. You know, we put in our statistics for FY24. Sorry, the printer, it looks like maybe I'm running a little out of ink. things look pretty good. I know typically, again, summers can be a time of lower attendance, or definitely some individual programs that had lower attendance, but there were others that had high attendance. Game day has been phenomenal this past month. We've had really big numbers, which has been great. You know, so
enjoying the air conditioning on those tough days.
You know, so it's really been you know, pick and choose, but overall the numbers are still trickling up from where they were, which is great.
I just wanted to mention very quickly, if I may, in Nisha's report, she mentions that she now gives out the list on the mystery rides. It's a list of the things that you can do while you're in that locale and places you can possibly go for lunch. I went on the mystery ride with Marie. We were there last week and we went to Kennebunkport, and she handed out, or the driver, Joe, handed out those lists. So we were able to, we looked and said, oh, we want to take a trolley ride. Yeah. So I went right on my phone, made reservations for the trolley ride, and we were able to do that. Whereas if we had waited and then tried to find where it was, and we probably wouldn't have made it.
Yeah.
And it was great suggestions from us. So that's a wonderful addition.
Yeah, and that's really because, again, people told us that that would be helpful.
So do they get it? Do people get it when they get on the van?
Yeah. Yes. So we debated on when, or she debated on when it should be given. Should they get it when they come in? We thought no, because then people will chat in the entryway.
You
want the mystery part. So when everybody's on the van.
Yeah.
That's good.
It was great.
Awesome.
Glad
to hear
that. Wonderful lunch.
Yeah, and then in this month's newsletter, you'll also see that we put the price range of some of the restaurants. If it's a restaurant that we are going to, you'll see the range. So we'll look at the menu, make sure that we see somebody at that lowest price range and what the top price range is, so that people can plan. So August 22nd, the Magic Show and Pizza coming up, that's actually no longer sold out. It was, then understandably, some plans have changed for people. And we have a couple of open seats. We went through our wait list and now it's open. So if people are out there and or in here that want to join us, please give us a call. I think it was like 3 or 4 seats as of yesterday that were open. So would love to have you there. Woodman's of Essex is coming on August 27th. That is currently sold out, but again, there's always a waitlist one could be put on. And oftentimes we do call that waitlist, especially the day before, so you can come in. We have all of our regular programming, weekly programming. I just want to reiterate again that we really sincerely appreciate it if people would let us know, particularly for line dancing and for meditation, if you're coming. So the teachers can plan accordingly, specifically line dancing. You know, that particular teacher, Susan, she wants a set number of people for a class. So people are coming, would love to have you. Just let us know so we can make sure to have plans. Coming up soon. So a couple of new things coming up, you'll see in the newsletter, which will go out email later today. Tax Work-Off Program Info Session, the first one is September 13th. There will be another one in October. We're doing a Fall Prevention Week in September, and then we're introducing a new program called the Community Knowledge Series. Our first one will be on September 9th or 10th, I believe. Let me double check. September 10th at 1 o'clock, and that will be with community member Charlie Herman, and we have a guest by the name of Catherine Eason from Edward Jones. That should be a great time. So again, newsletter will go out via email later today. We have them in our office right now for people that want to pick up a hard copy. Will definitely be distributed hard copies by next week, if not before. Any thoughts on upcoming programs?
And it's only August 21st.
I know.
Wow.
We plan through June, so we are good. That's a whole nother thing when we talk about plans. The point, yeah, we wanted it early, and you all have the dates, is because number one, Groveland residents have priority registration for the trips. So Groveland residents can register between now and through the end of the month for the day trips. Again, suggestion by the community that we've implemented. Happy to do it. So we wanted to make sure it was like well worth the time to have pre-registration. And then as of the 1st of September is when community members from surrounding towns can register for the trips. And that can be for both September and October trips. And we also want to make sure that people register for things coming up at the very first of the month and have time to get word out and make that. Pantry update. It was a pretty big month for the pantry. I think it's pretty similar to what we saw last summer. So, you know, Carrie and I are definitely learning the ebbs and flows of the pantry. So, you know, over just nearly 1,700 pounds of food was given out last month, which is a lot.
How has it been incorporating excess produce from people's gardens into the pantry?
Can I make a quick comment on that?
Yeah.
On Facebook in the town crier, a woman was asking, I have an abundance of tomatoes and cucumbers, what can I do with them? So myself and many people suggested things. I suggested, of course, our food pantry and said how thankful our older adults are to get it and, you know, to thank them for doing it. So I'm pretty sure she was going to bring in
that was the question.
Yeah.
Does the food pantry accept them?
And
you were the one, everyone's going, oh, go here. Oh, I can make sauce for you. It's like, you're the one that said, yes, they do.
Hopefully she did that, and maybe that will encourage others as well, because fresh produce is always certainly in high demand. Mm-hmm. So appreciated. So anybody out there who has an abundance of garden produce.
Absolutely. I mean, make sure that you would want to eat it. So I just want to be mindful of that. If you would want to eat it and you have excess and would like to give it to those that don't have access to it, we would love to be able to distribute that. If you don't, if it's something that you wouldn't eat, then perhaps you can get something
else. If there's
chipmunk
bites in it, we don't
want it. Have people chipmunk been taking my produce? Needles.
Have been, as in
using members, it? Yes.
Taking
it out?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, absolutely.
Great.
Yeah. Good. So really appreciate that. The other food pantry news is that we're going to do a public Amazon wish list. That should be set up shortly. Again, for people that shop on Amazon and would like to donate that way by purchasing specific products, you can do that. Certainly, you don't have to do it from Amazon. I can just give you ideas. Oh, it looks like they need coffee. Then we can go get coffee. Just another way to bridge that gap there for people. So we'll make that available as soon as it's ready. Any other pantry updates? I'm looking at our pantry volunteers. So.
It does come and go very quickly.
Yeah.
Whatever comes in goes out.
Yeah.
Oh, good.
Which is good.
Yeah.
And they do love the produce.
Oh, that's good to know. Yes.
I will say, as of earlier this week, you know, we talked about it. It's an annual thing that the state funds, with actually a federal program for farmers market vouchers. So we were given 20 of them for our constituents. We have about 3 left. It is income based. So if you are interested, you know, definitely give us a call or stop by, and it's $50 with the coupons. All you have to do is check the box, sign your name, you get it, and it's available at definitely Wally's, Chris's. I feel like Long's is probably doing it too. So yeah,
I think in Bradford,
the Bradford, yeah,
yeah, that, they're at Wally's there, yeah.
Excellent.
Programming, I know we're running short, so I'll just put it here. As I alluded to, we had a great planning session just last week, but certainly it's been talked about over the past couple of months, wanting to plan for the year ahead, which is new for us, so it's exciting, just so that we can have areas of focus to help us be more structured and being able to meet the needs of the community as far as we're aware. So coming up in September, I'll name that as Fall Prevention Week, where, you know, we definitely have a fall prevention program, but there's so many things that we do already that that lend itself to preventing falls. 3B Fit, meditation, line dancing, all of those things help. So for those that pre-register for those classes, we will we will take up the bill on that. So, you know, try it out for free. Would love to have you join us. Just a really great benefit health-wise and just meeting people. And then October, of course, is Ageism Awareness Month. Super excited about, or Ageism Awareness Day is actually October 9th. We just love to celebrate it all month, so that's why I said it. That is also when our first book club meeting is. This Chair Rocks by what is her name?
Ashton
Applewhite.
Yeah.
She's doing a talk today. I sent board members a link. I'll put it on Facebook on Facebook later today. But yeah, it's a really great book and something I think all of us of all ages can work on. You know, is that internal ageism piece. Because then also, how do we talk about it out loud when we get those birthday cards and say, oh, you know, 5 bazillion candles and, you know, that, like, you know, so we just have to figure out how to navigate those conversations. And certainly a large part of it is the language that we use, including, you know, I know you're working on the bylaws, which we'll do that too. So appreciate that. Any thoughts on upcoming programming that we're working on for the year? All right. So the last things I have to do with goals. So I know that was a separate sort of conversation. So I will let that be. So we're ready to talk.
All right. Very good. Thank you very much. Friends of the Council on Aging update. I noticed Mr. McKelly brought in his little wagon and his jug of points.
I will begin by saying that Alyssa is always a tough act to follow. But here's my attempt. So this jug was one I could easily lift with one hand. I can lift it with two. But we have two weeks left. And for anyone at home who hasn't heard about our summer coin drive, we're looking to fill this jug as much as possible to fund a friends fund, which would be at the discretion of the director of the Council on Aging to help people out in small but significant ways, out of budget items. So this is our container. Anyone who would like to stay after the meeting and help me figure out what to do with the Barbie wagon over there. I think it's cute too. So we will, that'll be part of our appearance at the Everything on Wheels parade for Groveland Day. So we'll be wheeling this around.
And when maybe is that taking place?
On Groveland Day.
Oh, well,
on
Groveland
Day. On Groveland Day.
It's out there on Facebook.
See, this is the problem, that we don't have a local newspaper.
Facebook isn't local news.
No, but it's happening. Facebook is such a horrible, contentious place that you have to read through.
They've been putting it out front at all?
You have to read through everything else on the sign out front,
Groveland Day?
I haven't seen it.
The digital sign?
No, but we still have things from 2 weeks ago.
Well, we have put it somewhere. make sure that people know once we know our son.
I'll talk to my daughter. She's on the Groveland committee. I'll see her today. Yeah. So I'll say, what's going on? I did get your table. Well, as far as I know, I got your table put in for it and the table for the friends.
Well, there is an initiative in town. Mm-hmm. Some people have started to meet about being able to have regular communication, especially on the Groveland channel. With news from the community.
Are you tied in? Is the Council on Aging been tied in with that yet?
I think I've talked to Claire Walsh in general. I don't know if she's part of that.
Mike Dempsey.
I think Mike Dempsey is spearheading.
Yes. Okay. There is a meeting on the 28th, I think, where they are actually going to try to put together a podcast or some sort of program that will be televised. So they're actually going to be writing a script. I was not able to attend the first meeting, but it is something that I think allows the Council on Aging and the Friends to get the word out to about some of the things that are going on. So
it is August 28th.
It's the 28th, and it would be held at VZ.
VZ Park.
At
6:30.
Yes.
What day is it? Next Wednesday?
Wednesday. It's a week from
today.
So has anyone from the board made a commitment to participate?
I am going to participate as a friend.
I'm going to try to. I wasn't able to make the first meeting either. I've got the second one on my calendar, so.
Okay, good.
Hopefully.
Yes.
Excellent.
I think it's a good thing to have.
Yeah.
So as far as the Friends are concerned, we did have a very successful performance of Rick Anthony Under the Big Top, who amazed us with his rendition of Roy Orbison songs. Did not quite make the 3-octave range, but he gave it a valiant try to hit the lower range, but that upper range is a tough one to make. But it was a great opportunity. It was a fundraiser, but more of a fundraiser that we enjoyed. Cover our costs, came out with a little bit more money than we expected, so that was a real good thing. We also have the summer coin drive going on for another 2 weeks, and that'll be part of our Groveland Day. I set a goal of attainable goal of $200. So we'll have a public counting of the and maybe a public rolling. If any of you ever worked out a job with you had to roll the cash at the end of the day, I will race you on rolling coins. We have a little competition there. Upcoming fundraisers, we'll continue with our fall calendar, which will come out in November. If you remember last year, we had a raffle where people bought tickets and there were drawings each day for different gift items and in some cases cash. We also have a bulb sale going on, a spring bulb sale with a deadline of
September 30th.
Those bulb sale brochures will be available both in the Council on Aging office and at Groveland Day. And
if anyone has taken a brochure, we have discovered that we have the wrong Venmo address after I printed them all out. So if you want to send it Venmo or do a Venmo, it's Karen Susie, all lowercase. Susie is spelled Soucy at SM. Groveland.
No,
they're doing it wrong. Friends of Groveland. .coa. Oh, now I'm second guessing.
Maybe they should call. Maybe I should call someone if they need the address.
Yes, you know what? Then that's the other thing. I know we put the I changed them there, but I don't know who has brochures and if they're doing Venmo, but we tried to do it the other day and you have to have that job. They do have it in the office if they're going to get it. But if anyone wants to place an order I don't mind. They can take my phone number. Is that okay to do?
Up to you.
Yeah.
I think probably we could just put it up on the Council on Aging website.
Will you do that? Have a brochure and you're going to try doing Venmo with any of your people, please look at the website. There we go.
Friends website. I will do okay, that.
Thank you. So I was given the wrong address.
And Larry, I have one question. What is the deadline for turning in gift certificates to the Friends for the calendar?
Good question. We really have until the end of September, because we just want to have it all in place. At the end of September is probably will be reasonable, because we would then need the calendar to be published in the November, December newsletter. And I'd just like to add one thing. We are, the Friends are an organization that's evolving. We have had a change in board over the last year. And we welcome anyone who would be willing to help us with our fundraising. It could be a large or small fundraiser. Every penny counts. All of the money that we raise does go to the Council on Aging in support of programs and activities. We have our next meeting. Our meeting will typically be the first Thursday of the month, and so that I think is the fifth this year.
Yeah.
And our meetings are at 2:00. Come join us. We're a fun group. We enjoy. We laugh a lot. Come with an idea, or come to help with somebody else's idea. We're there to support each other and to support the mission of the Council on Aging. So please come and join us.
Thank you for everything. Well, we appreciate it. We did put in the newsletter, in regards to the Friends, helping Friends, that if we don't want the financial cost of any of our programming to be a burden on the community. So if there is ever an issue, please do speak with a staff member whom you feel most comfortable with, and I'm sure we can make that possible on that. Is because of the Friends support. So thank you.
All right, thank you very much, Larry. Future programs. Yeah, that has pretty much been discussed. And this is any other questions or any discussion about that? Give me a second. I'm gonna sneeze.
And there'll be a new newsletter.
Subcommittee upgrades.
Bylaw subcommittee. I have an email in to Rebecca and Jason Naves, Rebecca Oldham and Jason Naves. We're looking at the week of September 23rd, trying to meet. That's the earliest that
I'll be aware of
people. Oh, no. Well, oh, yeah. Oh, I'll be. Well, I know Larry said he would be able to come. I just would have that Tuesday, the 24th at 10:15. I'm checking. I haven't heard back from them yet.
Yeah.
They couldn't do it earlier. I couldn't do it the week before because I'll be away. and you wanted to be on that.
Yeah, I can't be there. I'm gone.
Okay.
I leave September 25th and I don't come back until October 6th. And then I'm gone. But then Tuesdays, I'm never available anyways in the daytime.
Okay. Right. Well, I just said that, just gave a date.
So
the earliest she could do is the week before, but I'm away. I'm finally going somewhere. Well, she's at that medical work.
I mean, it doesn't at this point in time, it doesn't have to be.
So October 6th, but then
when was you want to make it.
How about we just look at November or October?
I mean, yeah.
I mean, because then you're going away again.
Yeah.
We want the whole community.
Only a small trip. Only a small trip then. November's good.
Okay, so how about November? I will.
But no Tuesday.
But no Tuesday.
Right.
Okay. Okay, or Friday. All right, there we go. I'll know what that means. Okay, that's my thank you. It's been a vacation for the summer for them, and now we do our vacations when all the kids go back to school. So, yeah.
Any other subcommittee updates to discuss? Okay, thank you. Moving on, is there any other business to be discussed other than what's on our agenda? All right. Then the next is discussion of August meeting focus area, which is the COA board and director goals for FY25, which Melissa alluded to earlier.
So I don't know how you all normally work on your goals. I will say
this is a new area.
I think there's a lot of backwardsness in how I would traditionally go about it. So we did our FY25 town budget in really January. And at that time, we had to develop FY25 department goals. And we weren't ready to develop individual goals. I tell you, they're still early in last fiscal year. So that's when we developed our department goals, and I put them on here. And then at annual review time for the staff is when we discussed our individual goals.
Right.
So I, you know, put them together because they all are related. It just didn't chronologically get together. So I didn't name any specifics who belong to who, but these are collectively as a staff the goals that we are working on. So, I mean, I don't need to read them out unless you would like me to, but then I don't know. I also, after I put our staff goals on page 10, I started listing our department goals. Mm-hmm. And then I don't know if board goals are like, Alyssa, you need to focus on, or okay, now that I've gone out of order, some staff goals are already set. How what you all would like to do.
Can I make a proposal that now that the goals are written out and we know what you're thinking and the staff is thinking, kind of starting with the end in mind and working backwards.
Mm-hmm.
And because of the time and because of the other presentation we've had, unless we have another pressing issue for our September meeting, I would feel comfortable really taking time to read these, think about these, process. I need time to percolate information like this. And then maybe I propose we come back and have a more in-depth discussion in September.
Mm-hmm. I think that's a good idea. I'd also like to suggest, though, that we do as a board need to have board goals.
Okay.
As a board, we need to have board goals.
Yes.
Oh, so while we're reviewing these, I think we all need to also be thinking as a board, what are our goals? And to Alyssa's point, I mean, really, board goals, you know, board goals should drive, director's goals should drive individual contributor goals.
Right.
Yeah.
So we need to, we almost need to do 2 years worth of goals for the board. We need to be looking, I mean, at this point, the 25 goals are done. As Alyssa said, just the way the timing is.
Mm-hmm.
I think that when we do all review these, get our thoughts together, perhaps what we should be developing is our 26 goals.
Yeah.
Because we're going to start budgeting for that in a few months.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's what we kind of, and I don't think they're going to be very different. I mean, I think we're all very much aligned. So I don't think there's going to be any real surprises. But rather than spending a lot of time saying the board goals for FY25 are, what's mm-hmm. the point?
Mm-hmm.
So that's what we should be viewing, I think.
Right. Goals with respect to our mission.
Yes.
Hmm.
So, you know, and again, we don't, at the board level, we don't need a lot. Right. We shouldn't have a lot of goals. It's up to, you know,
the staff.
The board has the vision. I mean, actually, we all really know it's Melissa that has the vision, but it sounds better if you say it's us. The board has the vision, and then Alyssa translates that vision into action.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Well, excellent suggestions and thoughts. Thank mm-hmm. you for that. And when we do come back, yes, we all as a board need to express and contribute our thoughts as to goals for the future. But perhaps we could also talk about maybe making a subcommittee, a goals subcommittee, mm-hmm. ongoing and continuing. In the future. But yes, definitely let's come back and revisit this when we've all had a chance to look at it and digest it and process it.
So September COA board meeting focus was goals.
Mm-hmm.
So that's perfect. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I mean, I think even in general, Irene and I talked about this a little bit, that even if we did have, let's say, an hour to talk about it today, it's a lot to just say,
yeah.
talk about it, stamp of approval in one okay. in 1 hour.
I tried to do it.
Yeah, for sure.
So,
all right, great, then that's sure. one.
Good.
That's going to be the area of focus for the next month.
That's just, I guess, one other thing. Mm-hmm. I mean, we did start the monthly focus areas. Think at my suggestion
right
quite a while ago.
That was your but I think goal for us
but I think directing the reason for that at the time was because it was a relatively new board. We were severely understaffed
and
I thought it was a good way for us to learn things.
Yes.
So I don't necessarily think that needs to be wrote. You know what I mean? I don't think every month.
Every September we do.
Right, we don't have to do that. I mean, we have a handful of things that we need to do every year, I think. But maybe let's think outside the box and mm-hmm. figure out a better way. Again, I just don't think it needs to be rote.
Yeah. I would love to have more guests, you know, come yeah. in and speak to the board and community.
And another thought, I think I read it in the report for meeting makers and issues. Somewhere I read about getting a handbook, a board handbook together.
Yeah.
So that when we do have new members, it does explain what not only the anachronisms, yeah. but you know, it takes a while to learn. You know, what's the donation account? What's the
mm-hmm.
you know, all these names. What is FY25 or FY26? That took me a long time. I didn't know what that was when I first joined the board.
Yeah.
And I'm like, what's an FY? Oh,
yeah, I think here. Barbara and I
never dealt with that.
And I think that at the time, there were a couple of others on that as well. We have talked about that. I mean, we can't possibly cover every single thing in it, but it could be general and who to talk to about this.
Right. And we had a lot of, Alyssa has provided us in the various other focus months, a lot of great reference material.
Yes. Yes.
Like elder law. Our handbook doesn't need to say it, but it can say for elder law issues, you know, these are the places to go. This is the general overlay, you know. So I think.
Or if it's all online in one place under handbook. I mean, we don't have to say, here's a paper handbook of, 50 pages. And then they interested. That's where I can find that chapter or whatever, because you have it all.
Yeah, digitally. We thought about incorporating some of that also into the front so that, you know, everybody mm-hmm. knows how these three pieces work, you know, the front, the board, the office.
Right.
And what responsibilities who has, what
responsibilities,
and what things you can't do.
Right. We're not micromanaging.
I feel as if this board is maturing nicely
as we develop and grow.
I mean, well, adversity is the best teacher.
I've been on the board for a long time, and this is the best board, really. I mean, like you say, we've grown, we're doing things, we're active COA. I mean, the numbers alone just show what's been happening. And the friends we've Yeah, we're in a very good place.
Yeah. And Sharon, as a visitor to our board meeting today, you're most welcome, and we're so glad you're here. I hope you come back. Not to put you on the spot, was there anything that you hoped to glean today or learn today? Did you have any questions of the board, or are you just soaking it all in today?
I am soaking it all in, but it's a great run meeting. You know, it seems to me like I've sat on boards before that, again, as people said, this board is really gelled, you know, pretty much on the same page. And I'm really happy. I asked Alyssa, was it okay if I came? You know, and I asked you whether people come, and she said no. And I don't know if that's something that could be put out there. You know, it's like everyone's welcome. Maybe you already do that.
I put a newsletter, but we could probably push it a little bit more. We have said that. Yeah.
And I mean, that's why we're not used to seeing people. That's why I asked who you were. Yeah. Well, yeah. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to be rude, but you know, usually we don't have. That's, I mean, Larry's our only guest, and he was on the board just a few months ago.
I think that, you know, my first meeting was the first televised meeting, and I do hear from people that they watch us on the cable. Yes. So I think that's an element to why we don't often have people. Mm-hmm. But it would be good. And as I'm thinking of it, if I don't come to this next thing, that I would like to have the Friends board meeting added to the calendar, because I think we could also.
It's also mentioned in a little.
She put it on. Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I hadn't seen the new calendar, but you know, there's the Friends also. Mm-hmm. And we are trying to build an organization too. So we welcome people and invite your participation. So we'll hopefully see you next Thursday.
I will be there.
And bring some friends.
I know, but that's the thing. I just moved to Groveland in March. I just quickly, my husband and I lived in Florida for the past 10 years. He passed away. And my daughter and son-in-law live in Groveland. So I visited Groveland numerous times. They've been here 15 years. And when I first moved back up here, I had hoped to find something in Groveland to rent, because I didn't want to own anymore. And there was nothing available. I lived in Georgetown and Raleigh. So I ended up in Newburyport for 2 years. I know they have a really active COA, but I never felt connected there. When I moved here, I felt an immediate connection. I grew up in a small town similar to Groveland, out in the western part of the state. And, you know, I just felt really comfortable, you know, coming in and being a part of the COA. And and I like to be active. I'd like to be involved.
Welcome to Groveland. COA.
And you know, there are some things like this development and you know, and then kind of how things get funded. And so I'm just really interested in trying to see if I have anything to contribute.
Awesome.
Wonderful. Great. The answer is yes.
Yes, thank you.
Yes, please.
Thank you so much.
This is nice.
Our next scheduled meeting is Wednesday, September 18th at 9:30. And is there anything else to be discussed, questioned before we adjourn?
Unfortunately, I'm my daughter and I are actually taking a mother-daughter trip, leaving on the 18th on the river cruise. So.
Emily,
I'm gonna be gone for a couple of weeks, but that'll be back.
You're having a wonderful time.
Yeah. No, it's on the Danube. No, it's a Uniworld.
Oh,
my husband and I did a number of those.
My sister and brother-in-law did like 6 Uniworlds and couldn't say enough good things about them.
Yeah.
So well, that's great. I have a good time.
Yes, enjoying.
Yes.
It's a beautiful area.
I've been there. In fact, there's only one country I haven't been to that's on the itinerary, but I wanted her to experience what, you know, her father and I had experienced.
Fun.
Can you adopt me?
Yeah.
Sure. Well, that's great. Thank you. All right, may I have a motion to adjourn the meeting at 11:02?
Motion.
Second.
All those in favor? Thank you very much, everyone.